I was upstairs, and Jasmine came and got me. And I told the Lord that I'm not going to come downstairs. I was provoking the spirit, right? I was provoking the spirit. Not an unloving spirit, but a spirit of the Lord, right? Because the Holy Spirit is a real being. Amen? And the ugly bird gets the worm, right? Okay. You see all crust in your eyes. but that's good though, because the Lord needs more people that's hungry for him. Yeah. No matter if it's 6 in the morning, or 5 in the morning, or 4 in the morning. Amen?
Amen.
I was convicted this morning, because I would get up every day, right? At 4:30 in the morning, I work out and I go to work. But I was convicted this morning, because I slept on God this morning. I slept in, and I brushed my teeth. After I got through brushing my teeth, my wife woke up. Boy, I woke her up. But she was getting dressed, and I said, "Baby, I don't feel it. All this week I wasn't fasting. I wasn't prayed up, and I got to preach God's word." But she didn't even say anything. Immediately, the Spirit said, "It's not about you." Amen. Yeah. Yeah. It's not about how you feel.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Now, I told God to help me on my crying, because I'm a crybaby. But this is something I'm really passionate about, and we should all be passionate about. Because when you really believe that someone has gave their life for you, you should feel it. Last week at the Bible study, well, this past week, I told them, I'm like, baby, it gotta be the same thing when you believe and when you feel. See, somebody can't believe that somebody did like, but when you feel it, it's emotional to you, right? But let's all stand for the reading of God's word. Matthew 27. 24 through 32, and then we're going to jump over to 28. It's Matthew 27, 24. And we're going to jump over to 28. Matthew 28. Pilate delivered Jesus to be crucified. So when Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." And all the people answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." Then he released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, delivering him to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole battalion before him, and they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and they twisted together a crown of thorns, and they put it on his head and put a scepter in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they spit on him, and he took the scepter and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him to be crucified. Over to 28. Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen." Amen.
Amen.
Lord, we come to you today, Father God, just to open up our hearts, oh Lord, to be more receptive of your Lord, to be more receptive of your word, Father God. We believe, Lord, and we come today as a whole, that we believe that you actually gave your life, Lord. It's not something that we just do out of tradition, Lord, for we know, Lord, that you can call us home any day, Father God. So we pray, Lord, that this word fall on good ground, Lord. That this wisdom does not come from me, Lord, but only from you, Lord. And today, Lord, let not me act like I know it all, or I want to just display my own wisdom, Lord, but only the wisdom that comes from you, Father God. In Jesus' name, amen. The cross. What is the cross? Amen. What is the cross? Is it something that we hang on a wall or we wear around our neck? All right. What is the cross? Today we just get that so backwards of what the cross really means. Why do we come to church? It's because of the cross. Right? The cross represents God's great love for you. And that's it, right? Amen. The crucifixion. The Bible doesn't go in detail of the crucifixion, but if you research, the crucifixion was the highest death sentence that the Romans gave to criminals. Right? It was a sentence like today. If a criminal was sentenced to death, it's a death penalty. All right. Okay. It was meant for public shame. Only for public shame. And when you go through history, thank you, Pastor. When you research, everybody that was crucified naked. Amen. But the Bible does not go in detail of what all that happened to Jesus. He was flogged, which means that he was tortured and beaten. The Roman soldiers viewed this as a great joke. They didn't know that this man was the Son of God. That he was a regular man claiming to be the Son of God. So they put a scepter in his hand, and a robe, and a crown. Mocked him. They didn't know. But they beat him. They took flesh and tissue off of him. And when I was younger, I always thought that, well, since he's the Son of God, right? I figured that he had the power to not feel the pain that the Roman soldiers did to him. But he felt all the pain. All right? That you deserve. And that you deserve. Amen? But we have to believe this, though. It means nothing if we don't believe it. And I know I always say that, but believe it. Because if I don't believe this, if you don't believe this, where else can you go? Amen? All right? What other person can you follow? I know I can't follow nobody else. But his purpose for dying, though. Do you ever wonder what he was thinking when he was on that, when he was hanging on that cross? A guy came into my work this week, and I was like, "Yeah, man, I'm preparing a sermon for this Sunday. I'm just all jacked up, having a study. I'm all jacked up." And he said, "Are you gonna preach on the resurrection?" I said, well, "Of course." Well, he said, "Why?" I said, "Because of these things. Are you tradition? Are you doing this out of tradition, right?" And he said, "Let me ask you a question. If you want to preach something different, imagine what Jesus was thinking about when he was hanging on that cross." But I know when I'm in pain, I don't care about nobody else but me, but my medical attention, right? But look at Jesus, all right? He hung there, right? Gasping for air, right? Right? And he thought about you. So you can be with him. So we went down there to St. Louis for Vanetta's grandma's funeral, right? And the Bible says, it's better to be at a funeral than be at parties. Amen. And I realized that, right? Because when I sat there, you know, people mourning and all that stuff, and I'm like, wow, life is really real. That is real. One minute she's baking me sweet potato pie.
All right, all right.
Another minute she's gone. Just like you. One minute you here, and you gone. But today is a new day. But while we come to church, though, that's the point. Church should be every day, right? But today, God woke us up at the crack of dawn. The early bird is the worm. And I was listening to a sermon by Tony Evans, and he said, have you ever seen a bird just hanging there in a nest with his mouth open waiting on a worm to drop down? No. The bird go gets the worm, but the Lord provides the worm. Amen? Amen. So what God has provided for you? Say that. Think to yourself that. What God has provided you? Is it materials that you're after? Is it personal gain, pleasure, right? But do you love him and worship him for who he is? See, a lot of folks worship God for what they can get from him. A lot of people worship God for, if I do this. No, that's religion, right? Amen. That is religion.
Yeah.
Mm. Lord, just move.
Yeah.
Move, God. When I was writing this, the Lord had me visualize a painter, right? Mm-hmm. And a painter, they gather their thoughts, right? Mm-hmm. And they paint. Mm-hmm. And then after their project, they have the power to keep it or throw it away. Ain't you glad that God put you there? Amen? Ain't you glad? But he gave you another chance. And another chance. And another chance. And another chance. Amen. Amen. Gave you another chance, which you don't deserve. You don't deserve it. You don't deserve the chance. Forgive me, I'm blue ribbon. No, I'm not crying. This is the only thing I cry about is this. This is the only thing I cry about is this. Because he didn't throw me away. I can't imagine myself standing up here years ago preaching. God is good and he's real. That's gonna be there before you was born and after when he take your life. Cause that he has no patience, right? Amen. Death got no patience, no time limit. When it comes for you, it's coming for you. Amen. But God got a power over that. But he just gave authority to the enemy. God has power over death, but he just gave the authority to the enemy. Amen? In the Old Testament, when death came, right? When death came, they had to put blood on the door, right? So death will pass.
All right.
So the enemy, yes, he has authority over death, but God has power over it.
Yeah.
And he chooses who he will take power. You can be today. You can be this year. How serious are you taking this? Are we praying, church? Are we praying to an actual God? Or is he praying to our thoughts? Or just because it feels good? But God demonstrates his own love for us while we were still sinners. Christ died for us. God didn't wait to fix you. God didn't wait for you to fix yourself.
All right,
say that. Amen. While we were still sinners, he still
still, that's crazy, he still begged for forgiveness while he was being crucified on that cross.
Yeah.
I remember I was working with juvenile kids, right, at the state in Kansas City. And I came up with a topic. I said, if you had a time machine, right, who's on the roof? If you had a time machine, right, when would you go back in time? I said, all right, what timeline would you go back and why? So they have to choose a timeline or way back a time period and why they go back. Some say, oh, I'll go back to Tupac or to see who shot Tupac. Some say, I'll go back in the Egyptian time, right? And then I didn't say anything. They're like, yeah, well, what would you, I didn't say anything. That was just them. But I got convicted after that. After I left work, I sat in my truck and I was like, wow. Because I wanted to go back in Jesus' time. But I was afraid because I could have been the one that crucified him. I could have been the one that was like, crucify him.
Okay.
Don't think that you out of the quicksand because you're living in these times.
Amen.
You could have been the one back then that would crucify him. And sometimes we just get so religious by that we forget that God will look out for us.
Come on, right?
Yeah. I know I do. I get puffed up and God has to bring me down. I get puffed up and God has to bring me down.
Yes.
I get puffed up and had to bring me down again. Down again, down again, down again. But it's for a purpose though, right?
Right.
It's for a purpose. Because if you look at a building, right? A construction building. Sometimes they remodel it, but other times they bring in a wrecking ball.
Okay.
And they have to break it. They have to bust it. They have to do that whole, take it all away and build a new one. See, God, I'm telling you, all of us, he has to break you. He has to come in with a wrecking ball and break you. Only because to build you up, though. Okay, right? Only to build you up. This is coming from God, not from me. Praise God.
Yes.
To all this week, I didn't have a message. But it's good though, because I rely wholly on the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
I rely wholeheartedly, and you should rely wholeheartedly on the Holy Spirit. Because it's real. Life is real. Heaven is real. Don't no movie gotta tell me that. Don't no movie gotta tell me that. I know heaven is real. I know when I read this, word is real. You go to any, be like, man, you know this man-made book. You know this and that. You know this and that. Did God really say? Did God really say? Did God really do this? Did God? Yes, he did.
Amen.
Faith. No matter what it look like, I'm going to do what you say.
Yeah.
You tell me it's okay, and I believe I'm straight. Because he says it. The war already done with. The wages of sin is death, though. But the gift of God is eternal life. When you look at a wage is something that is payment. It's something that is owed to you, right? Okay, we were looking at Fences a month back with Denzel Washington. And one scene in the movie, Denzel Washington said, he was talking to his son, right? And he said his boss doesn't pay him because he likes him. His boss pay him because he owed it to him. Your sins, yes, we is old. Sorry, I'm stuttering. But that's a blessing though, because I could have been born with no legs, amen.
Right.
A wage is something that is paid to you, owed to you. Your sins, something that's owed to you. Man, thank God for paying that, right? And even if you look through history, your freedom is not free. If you look through all history, freedom is not free. Something have to, somebody or something have to sacrifice. Amen? But this right here, I'm telling you, this right here is the, I'm telling you, I'm telling you, we have to make it real every day in our lives. At times, I ask for forgiveness every day. Lord, forgive me for being lazy in your word. Forgive me for taking you for granted. Lord, forgive me. I said, Lord, put me in the Middle East so I can live with you more, so I can have people chasing me after you. Put me somewhere, Lord, that I can be persecuted, Lord. We don't know what true persecution is in this country.
All right.
Amen. We don't know what true persecution is.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen. But that's the same tool.